Well, nice to see you here. Good morning and welcome to this session. So Lydia actually asked me that I should come here and give a tutorial on neural machine translation or machine translation in general. I wasn't really sure what to prepare and how to prepare. I didn't know much about this conference. I didn't know really who was going to attend this tutorial. So let's see what will happen. If there's something that really seems to be too boring or too you already familiar with all of these things, then we can also skip certain parts. So my idea is more or less to talk a little bit about the past, the development of machine translation, and then especially going into neural machine translation and some models that have been proposed in recent years. Maybe I should say a little bit about myself. So my name is Jörg Tiedemann, as you can see here. I am a professor of language technology at the University of Helsinki since 2015. So 2 years ago I moved to Helsinki, which is now very close to St. Petersburg, and this is really a good chance to get here. For me, the first time in St. Petersburg, so I hope that I can also see something of the city. You fixed even the sun for me, that's really nice. I heard that this weather was quite different some days ago. So what else can I say about myself? I'm really interested in working with multilingual data. So if you have data sets in lots of different languages, then you can do a lot of interesting things. Not only machine translation is something that we will talk about here, but for me it's really fascinating what kind of information can you get out of data, in the sense that you can learn from data. I will probably come back to this a little bit later. But the most common thing that you think of if you have parallel data sets is that you can learn machine translation models. So this is something that people have been working with for a long time. There's a lot of people working on this topic, and it's one of the oldest applications that you can think of in language technology, machine translation. And recently there's really a lot of progress. And now I don't really know about your background. Maybe you can start by this and just asking how many of you work with machine translation to some extent? Okay, yes. So how many people have some background in, well, have heard about statistical machine translation, for example? Neural machine translation. So there are some people somewhere here and there. So in some sense, we can also do it in this way that I will go through some basics. And if there's also something that you want to discuss more, you can always interrupt and ask questions, or maybe also add new or other types of information. Because also, I don't know all the answers. So if there's something else that you would add to the audience, we can also have this more like an interactive session, if you like. But let's see how we will do that. One thing that I also want to mention just in the beginning is that for this tutorial, I used a lot of information from other people. This is really nice in the field of neural MT and also deep learning in general, that most systems, implementations, but also documentation and information is available online. So you have these public resources, things that you can reuse, and people are typically quite open-minded in sharing things. So I really have to thank especially Kyung-Yung Cho, Rico Senrich and Barry Haddo, who prepared other kinds of tutorial slides. And I will reuse many of their pictures and images from those slides. So if you see something that you have seen before, maybe in some other places, it could happen that this comes from those tutorials. Okay. So my title here, as you can see, is called The Frustrating Past, The Exciting Present, and The Bright Future of Machine Translation, with this added thing of neural machine translation, because this somehow seems to be the bright future that we are looking at. We come back to a bit more historical things in a minute. But let's just get started by quickly saying why we want to talk about machine translation. And this is basically motivation. This is very slow, or I don't know, I do something wrong here. So machine translation is, of course, something that some of you have worked with, and I just want to motivate why this is interesting for us as a community. Machine translation has a practical use because it's really an end-user application, so we want to translate one language into another. We want to build a machine that can help us getting the information from one language into another. So the interesting, why this is interesting, is because, of course, the practical use. So we want to have something that makes our life easier, reduces especially also these kind of language barriers. And I can realize this now again, that coming here, different language, of course, there's a language barrier that prevents me from getting some information, just talking to a taxi driver. So there's a lot of practical use for machine translation that takes away the discrimination that we have because of language barriers. So something that we cannot communicate with each other just because we cannot understand each other. So language technology can help here in the sense that machine translation can really have this practical use. Then, of course, there's commercial interests, which are also behind building applications. But something that I, especially from an academic point of view, find really interesting is that if we want to do that task of machine translation, we really have to understand languages and how communication works, and how languages differ from each other and how they are built. So there's also this kind of linguistic interest here. And if we want to build that application, we really have to find out how languages work and how do they differ from each other. So in the field of machine translation, we can really see, or language technology in general, is that we have this mix of different fields coming together. We need expertise from linguistics. Of course, we need computer science as some background, because we have to develop systems that really work efficiently and that can learn, for example. It's a lot of engineering, where you have to find out what is the system, what is the interface that you have to build, how do you actually make this machine accessible by people. And translators and their translation studies and their expertise comes in here as well. So really multidisciplinary, I think that makes it very interesting as a topic. Another reason is because machine translation also is very difficult. So something that over the many years made a lot of problems and made people laugh. I think this is also one thing that really got the interest for many people working on that problem, because you can easily see that there's a lot of things going wrong. In the beginning of computational linguistics, or in the development of computers, people thought that translation would be easy, straightforward. But you could very quickly see that there can be so many different problems, because languages are much more complex than we realize as people, because we can handle languages without any problems. So some examples, you can find many of these examples online. So there's a lot of funny examples. You probably have your favorite ones yourself. If you just look in Google for some of these ridiculous examples that can happen. And this is from real life. So just slight changes can really make a big difference here. You can see here these examples. So let's don't get too much into these examples, but now consider the frustrating part, where past, where you can see that a lot of things went wrong. There was a lot of problems. It was only ridiculous to look at machine translation. People were laughing at the systems and saying that this is never going to work. So in the history, there was also a lot of talk about evaluations, where the final answer conclusion was that this is a waste of time. We cannot really spend more money on these projects, because it's not going to work. But slowly, some breakthroughs came in the history of machine translation. And nowadays, as we probably all sit here, we know these services that can be used and really make a difference. So now I moved 2 years ago to Finland. And Finnish is quite a different language to languages that I know about and that I can understand. So for me, it was really helpful to have just an online tool that can translate to some extent the language that I cannot understand. So even if you would laugh about some of the translations, even though there's a lot of problems that you can see, it became really a tool that is so helpful in moving around and makes it much easier to integrate. So for me, being in Finland, for example, I used Google Translate without making too much advertisement for Google here. But it was really a tool that I could use for all kinds of purposes. And this is typically also a slide that I show to students if I introduce computational linguistics, is that without realizing, we can see that in these services that we have online, a lot of the research that has been done in the field are integrated in systems. So there's much more behind the scenes than we typically see in some interfaces. So there's a lot of things like language identification, or speech is much more integrated nowadays. We have these handwritten text recognition. There's some kind of lexical information that is extracted from text and from data. There's spelling correction. All kinds of other tasks are implemented and integrated in these practical systems. So in some sense, language technology and computational linguistics is much more important for society than we would imagine, because it really surrounds us. It decides what kind of information we will get, what we will find on the internet, what we see on our phones, how we interact with machines. I get usually easy stuck in these motivation parts, but let's go back to machine translation. So if you look at machine translation, something that is really fascinating here, as I said before, is that it is really complicated and complex as a task. And why is that? So why is it really so difficult? You could think that, is it not easy just to give the translation of one sentence or one meaning that you express with language? But it is not, because languages are so ambiguous and depend on so many different factors that you can see that even humans do not agree on what is a good translation and what is a bad translation. So if you would ask translators to translate a sentence, you would probably get from all of them different translations for most sentences. So it's not, there's not a clear mapping one-to-one from one sentence or one text to another. You always have alternatives. It depends on lots of different factors. And if you want to ask, for example, evaluators how to judge a translation, they will come up with different answers here. Now, this is quite an old picture here from 2006. WMT is a yearly annual conference nowadays for machine translation, where they have a shared task and they do these evaluations. And you can see that having just evaluating adequacy, so how correctly is something translated, the judgments are very much different from one evaluator to the other. So there's a lot of reasons for this, and the reasons, some of them are just mentioned here. So you have ambiguity on all kinds of different levels: lexical level, syntactic level, semantic level, pragmatic level. So you have a lot of things that influence how you would translate and judge things. You have subjectivity, for example, something that you understand from what I say is probably different from your neighbor. So you have the understanding of language is not the same for all humans. We have some approximation of the same understanding, but there are slight differences. If I say this is nice weather today, this makes a different association from one person to another. There's a lot of stylistic variation, creative usage of language. It's very productive. We also assume a lot of world knowledge. So depending on what kind of cultural background and world knowledge you have, you might explain things in a different way. And concepts, units that bear some meaning, they are not really strictly defined as some discrete thing. This is exactly what it means and nothing else. It's always some kind of fuzziness in there. So this makes it complicated, and I don't know if you all agree, but I think that's, from my point of view, is really a reason behind the difficulties of machine translation. So all of this just motivation to work with languages in general, but especially also with machine translation. So now I have a few more slides about the history of the field. Okay, let's look at another picture from a book. So there's this machine translation introductory guide. It's quite an old one. So from that, it stops somewhere in 2000, so has some missing parts here. But you can see that there's a long history behind machine translation research. It really started in the early days, 1940s and 50s. It comes from the days when there was actually no computers But it was just, well, the beginning of development of machines and computers, and machine translation was one of the applications that people thought that computers would solve easily. So there was a lot of money and also interest in developing machine translation, and a lot of expectations. As you can see in the beginning, it really people started to implement some systems. A lot of money was pushed into that. And then there was this crucial point somewhere in the 1960s, when there was a report evaluating how well does it do. They wanted to translate English to Russian. I think that was one of the projects here called War Times. So of course there was this interest in getting this language pair done. And of course it was shocking how bad the system was then behaving. It couldn't basically translate anything that was beyond the little training sets that people have developed on. So after that report, it really crashed, and funding stopped, and no one wanted to be developing this kind of application anymore. And I think the field went back to some sub-problems. So computational linguistics focused more on syntactic analysis and things like that. But of course, machine translation was never really out of the picture. And you can see that also in these years here, like 70s and 80s, of course, it was developing, but slowly there was some commercial interest. And then it really took off again in the 1990s, and that was probably especially the advent of statistical models and then also data-driven techniques, where these techniques really came into the picture and made a difference, because of also computational resources were developing more quickly. Yes?
Sorry, just a quick question. Is there some interpretation to the height of this slope, or is just
no? No, it's only the expectations, I would say.
Expectations.
Yeah. No. So of course you cannot say that at that time you have this. It's not quality, definitely not, because the ARPA report in the 60s said that no, it's not working, and it was really some toy systems that couldn't handle things. Or maybe the number of people working on machine translation. I don't know. It could be different kinds of scales. Of course, this is only a cartoon picture of explaining some. Okay, so some of you have probably seen this kind of triangle before, and I think this is still a very good illustration of showing what we work on. So if you look at language technology, I see a very clear connection to machine translation, and machine translation is one of the things that really should be one of the most interesting topics to work on. And if you look at what we want to do, is we want to have some models for human languages. So we have any kind of human language, we have human languages, all the diversity that we can see in the world. We want to build computational models. That is computational linguistics. So some models that explain the languages. And there's basically two parts to it. So we want to have models that can understand language. So how can you get some language input in any kind of language using your model, and you understand and you get the meaning behind this, so you can really understand what is going on here. So you find out what is behind that language input. And the other part is speaking, so generating language. And altogether becomes, of course, then communication. That is maybe another dimension that we should mention here. But if you have understanding and speaking done and modeled, then we have solved most problems that we can see in computational linguistics or in language technology. And this picture here, of course, is one of these standard illustrations for machine translation, because the parts of understanding and speaking are typically the parts that we need for machine translation. So if you just put two different languages on each side, then we get this famous triangle that explains machine translation in this picture. That we want to find some models that can do understanding of some source language and speaking into another language. So this is basically what we want to look at. And then, of course, we have to consider what kind of models, what kind of strategies can we build for transferring source language input into target language. You really have to tell me if this is too basic here, and you get bored by this presentation here. So, but just for brief history again, so there was a lot of interest in taking this kind of expert-driven mode. We say that now we have some linguistic knowledge that we can apply, and we can instruct a computer to say, how do we do this understanding, how do we do that speaking? And typically this is done in symbolic ways, because an expert who has a linguistic knowledge tries to put this expert knowledge onto some formal descriptions. So an expert can define exactly and build a system that does that understanding and speaking. So I call this expert-driven or instruction-based, whereas on the other side we have the alternative approach, where we say that instead of getting the knowledge from an expert, we would like to look at data. So we want to learn information from data, and I call this example-based, even though that term is a bit ambiguous, because there's example-based machine translation, not really what I mean here, but any kind of data-driven technique looks at examples, a lot of examples, and tries to learn a model from that. So in many ways, those things can, of course, also be combined, but that's the basic ideas that we can have, either some expert knowledge or data that can build up these different models. And then, because we like practical solutions, there's lots of different ways of decomposing this into different components, saying that now I want to, for example, do some analysis. I might not really do the full understanding, but I just go on that line and do some analysis and try to get an abstraction from which I can transfer to the other language. So there can be pipeline approaches where you have some analysis, some transfer, some generation, or you can have direct mappings, maybe a little bit of abstraction inside of the model, or you can have, as we will talk about later, a two-step procedure where you try to first do some kind of understanding to some level and then go to speaking from that level and generating the output. Okay, so we will be in this picture with all our implementations. And let's just quickly go through the development. So it started with more the data-driven approach in the 40s. So there was this kind of encryption and information theory and encryption that was popular, saying that, well, I can probably try to learn to decode, more or less like decoding something that is a chiffre or some kind of encrypted text. So there's this famous quote here by Warren Weaver in the 40s, where he just said, okay, let's just assume that this text here is really written originally in English, but it's somehow encoded in some weird characters and weird way. So we just have to decode it into English again. And this is, of course, also something that is behind later models of statistical MTM. So the decoding terminology comes into the picture from that early time, that where we tried to decode things that have been encoded. So we assume that something is generated in the original source in the target language, actually, but it's somehow weirdly changed into something else, translated, for example, and then we have to decode, find the best back translation to the original one. Then if you look at expert-driven systems, then these are quite different from a point of view, saying that now we don't take that idea of something is generated already in some other language, but then strangely transformed. But instead, we really want to focus on the different components, saying that we want to have the linguistic analysis of the input. Then we do some kind of transfer to go from that abstract notation that we have created by analyzing the input, and then generating with linguistic knowledge the output into some target language. So for a long time, people have worked in this paradigm. Then in the 1980s, there's also yet another famous quote. People at IBM started to work on speech recognition. And then this, he's quite famous for this quote, also for other things. Fred Jelinek, he worked at IBM. And they had this team working on speech recognition. And then suddenly they got hold of parallel data, the Hansards, the translations from French to English, or English to French from the Canadian government proceedings. And they could train, and they wanted to see if they can have similar ideas like you have for speech recognition also applied to the problem of machine translation. And so the idea here was then really the invention of the early statistical machine translation systems, where you have human translations, these parallel texts that you can use as knowledge source, and you use some other texts, and you build models from this by taking the translations to model the translation parts, so the mapping from one language to another, which would be then the would model adequacy, so really how much is translated from the meaning of one language to another, and you could use monolingual texts in the target language that you try to translate to model the fluency of the translation, so what kind of grammatical output you can generate. So you use your learning algorithm that can just take things from data, and later on we will stay in this paradigm. So instead of being the expert who can really define that model that you try to create, instead the expert is now the one who is defining what kind of learning algorithm is used and how this works, and then this learning algorithm actually tries to estimate the model. So once you have the model, then you hope that this really covers the mapping between the two languages, and you have, in the end, you have some search problem. So now this model has to use the knowledge that has been internally coded in some way, and does this kind of decoding where you try to find this target language given some source language based on some probabilistic model in the case of SMT or statistical MT. Okay, so this was in the late 80s, early 90s, and then it really took off. And here's a bit of the timeline for statistical MT. We can see that from the early days, not much happened. But in the 90s, it really took off with the first implementations of word-based models. It was then inside of IBM. Efficiency was not really there yet. But in the late 90s and 2000s, then suddenly there was this boom. And I think something that also has to be mentioned here is that really important was the development of open source technologies, or some packages that everyone could use. So suddenly it was really easy to get started with, for example, the implementations of phrase-based SMT and some decoders and alignment models like this GISA++, or GISA and GISA++ that came into the picture, made it easy that teams could just pick the tools, data became available, and you could really experiment, develop yourself. So suddenly there was also commercial partners could then also take these basic starting points and then develop their own systems. And then of course then the commercial systems came out, like Google Translate in 2006, and they basically bought, they integrated the academic research. They just took the people to their team, built up a team, and then made a commercial product out of this idea. And for 10 years, Moses was then also the toolbox that was really dominating the field of machine translation as one of these open source toolboxes where you can just do all kinds of training procedures on data sets and integrating your new ideas. So very much important was to open up systems and open up data. Without that, machine translation would never be in the stage as it is now. And I think this was also one of the main problems in the early days, that there was actually no systems were open. In general, in research, everything was kept secret. And I can just point out, this is something that really prevents for any kind of breakthrough. So if you want to work in language technology, make sure that you open up things. Otherwise, your ideas probably get lost. Okay. So a little bit of prerequisites, because this is also important now for neural MT. So nothing is really possible if you don't have the data. So one of the most important things to have is really enough data to train on. And this becomes even more important for neural machine translation. We need a lot of instances for training your system on. So here, a picture of something that I really find fascinating is that parallel data is one essential source for a lot of different research. So if you collect these really rich types of information, then you can do many more things than just machine translation. And in some other talks, I could give more details about other ideas of how to use the information from translations. We will, of course, focus on empty. But something that we have to point out is also something that we really need is alignment. So we need to prepare parallel corpora and prepare in such a way that we have the basic information there that we can get started with to use some extraction methods and to use some learning algorithms to learn information from these data sets. So sentence alignment, nowadays ignored as one of the prerequisites, but this is also something that is needed for all models that we have to build. So you basically take texts that have been translated and use some automatic approaches to align them on a sentence level or some chunk level or some kind of other things. So there's a lot of simple methods that work quite well. And that's another challenge, to get more of these parallel texts for something that is not as clearly translated as this example here. From historical point of view again, so if you have statistical MT, another step of alignment was to align even smaller chunks. And here you have a picture of these famous IBM models where you try to align words to each other based on some statistical methods, so you don't need any more information instead of the sentence aligned data, and then you can find links between words using certain parameters, for example, in this IBM 3 model here, if some of you still remember that. So this is from the 1990 paper of the IBM team that kind of changed the world of machine translation. Okay, also quickly going through these advances that came out of the picture. So after these word-based models that didn't really work well because they made really strong independence assumptions, there were other models that were really successful, and for example the phrase-based models then really changed again the development to some higher dimension, where we now take larger units than just individual words, but they're still based on exactly the same, that we have word alignments here between word pairs, but we now take out larger chunks, and in this way we can carry some dependencies between words into a phrase pair. Basically the model is really stupid because it really extracts just a large memory of these phrase pairs. But it's really hugely efficient to do this, getting it, and you have a large database, and you basically look up things, and you can have some statistics that say that how likely is it that these phrases are really translations of each other, and you get that from the data. So if you look now at these models, they are not very sophisticated, they're basically counting in large memories. So then another addition in the development was the development of hierarchical systems. And this is probably, if you look at these really stupid models in the beginning, you're not really satisfied with this. Because you know from linguistics that on language, if you look at languages, there's a hierarchical structure, there's a productive way of producing certain expressions, and it's not just sequences of chunks that you arbitrarily put together somehow. But instead, you can also get these kind of hierarchical structures from data in more or less the same way. So now you can see that this again uses exactly the same prerequisites. We have sentence aligned units, then we do some word alignment, but now we can do some other kinds of extraction, and again just in a brute force way extract hierarchical phrases that can have certain variables. So in this example here we have a rather large phrase here, everything that is highlighted, but we can subtract from that big phrase a smaller phrase and replace it by a variable, and in that way we get this X here that can be replaced by other things. So we basically extract some rules that can have certain embedded structures in there. So these are the hierarchical phrase translation systems, and then a lot of work went into making it a bit more linguistic. So if you just extract something that you have one variable, but instead you want to have a little bit more linguistic knowledge, and there you can rely on other work that has been done in computational linguistics, where a lot of work went into syntactic parsing, for example, so you can syntactically analyze some sentence in one language, but you can also do the same in the other language. And then if you have that enriched source, you can you can get other types of rules that include even these advanced features from linguistic knowledge. Okay, so you might wonder why you sit here in NeuralMT tutorial where there's no NeuralMT at all, but I think this is important to also remember where it all comes from, what the development is. So just also to, because there will be some slides of evaluation, something that really also changed the field was ideas about automatic evaluation. So now, I don't know, all of you know Bleu? Do you know Bleu? Most, no, most don't. So something that really also changed the field was that you wanted to, if you develop things and you estimate models from data, you want to optimize systems, you need some way of checking that you do the right thing, so that you develop things in the right direction. So is it really getting better? Are you better than a different system? And if you do this for machine translation, then the problem is that evaluation, as I showed in one of the first pictures, is really difficult. You don't get any good picture and you have to involve humans to judge that. But then there was, and there is still a lot of work on how can you make an automatic evaluation for that. And there's an influential paper on that where they showed that simple matching between reference translations and output of some systems can approximate that evaluation. And this is this famous Bleu, or Bleu, or I don't know how you want to pronounce it. The Bleu measure, I would say, is then really just a precision score of matching n-grams between reference translations and system output. So you count for different chunks. How much do you also see that in the reference translation? And then with this measure, you can compare systems against each other. Of course, this is a very, simplistic way of measuring, but you could show that this somehow correlates with human judgment. Of course, there's a lot of discussion, how much is that doing? So there's extensions also where you can have multiple references, and then this becomes a bit more stable, but typically you only have one reference translation that you can do. But so this is really important for system development, and if you use that for developing your system and changing parameters and models, then after that you always need to do some other kind of evaluation where you can prove that the things that you measure are really improving our system here. Okay, but if I show evaluations, they are mostly using Bleu, and that is of course always a drawback, because from that you cannot for sure say that the system is really better if you just increase Bleu, but there's a good chance that you do. So coming back to where we are, so now we're coming back really slowly to our current times. So 2015, as I said, we have these annual evaluations of machine translation. There's a campaign at WMT. Anyone who participates in WMT here? No? Russian is part of it, so you should. So if you're interested in machine translation, this is the thing to really participate in, because you will get a lot of publicity by being part of this. And you can also see that you push the development of the language if there's more participants in that language. So really, if you want to go into machine translation, look at this and try to participate. And I believe that Russian will stay in the competition. I think this is sponsored by Yandex, so they will provide new test sets. It's really nice, the setup, because the machine translation community will then provide the evaluation framework. You have some time for preparing a system, then you submit your output for a given test set that you haven't seen before. And then the organization behind it will take care of evaluation, and you do evaluation actually by peers. So you will also evaluate output, and then you can compare your system with others, and there will be this conference where things will be discussed, and you will get a paper which is quite highly ranked in that field of machine translation. So I can recommend, if you want to work on MT, go to this WMT. But for showing the slides, so now I'm showing slides with Bleu scores, and you can see they are somehow in the 20s and 30s. So that's for you who are not really used to Bleu scores, this might look really disappointing. So this is in percentages. It can go up to 100%, but because you have it's only like an approximation of matching between system output and reference, it is not very likely that you get exactly the reference translation from your system output. And scores like 30 and 40 are actually quite high scores that you can get for reasonable translations. And the test set here is that's news texts, so rather complex sentences, quite long. Recent news, so something that the system not always can train on. So you can expect something like this. And you have also to say that you cannot exactly compare between different language pairs because the texts are not exactly the same. But you can see that somehow there's a tendency that certain language pairs work better than others, like French-English is now out of the system, out of the campaign, because there's no real progress and the systems perform quite well already, so we don't really want to have that challenge anymore. In Helsinki, we work quite a lot on Finnish, so this is of course something where you can see it's darker here, there's a lot of more that has to be improved. And Russian, I think, also needs still some push. You can see it's always in connection with English here. But why I want to show this picture is that this is the year after, so in 2016. It's not exactly the same languages here, there's some other like Romanian in here. But what I want to point out is here something happened. So if you only look at Bleu scores, of course we cannot really compare these numbers because the test sets will be different. But you can see that from 2015 to 2016, there was really a jump, something that we haven't seen before in that field, that for many language pairs, you went up in these Bleu scores, and also in the human evaluation, you could see that suddenly there was really an impressive improvement for many language pairs. Yes?
So you say that they have different test scores, test sets, meaning that so they change from 2015 to 2016, or they change between languages? So do they test on the same sets from year one?
No, it's always a different test set. So each year, so yeah, of course, it's not comparable, no. Yeah.
And I also have an idea that these scores are not symmetric for any language pair. So
no.
Maybe we could measure like which language is more difficult by taking the score that is lower because, well, you can map from German to English, but it's harder to map from English to German. Maybe
yeah.
It makes sense to say that German is more difficult. I don't
know. No, so I would say it differently. I would say that our current models are not as good for German than they are for English. Because I don't believe that German is a more difficult language than English. It has just other difficulties. And the models, like any model that has been created, is typically optimized for English, because there's more people working on English. And of course, these models really try to look at English as their prototypical language and try to optimize. For example, people always tell me, they always tell me, of course, that, and they're really proud in Finland, that Finnish is one of the most difficult languages in the world. I probably agree because of my background. But on the other hand, I have to say that Finnish is probably one of the easiest languages in the world because it's really regular, very regular. So it's somehow funny that this language doesn't work well with computational models, but it's because the models are not really much developed for that problem. So it's you focus on things that are nicely tokenized and things, and not that you have agglutination and all these kind of morphemes and so on. But I think there's many studies that look at, for example, how children learn language, and there's no proof that some language is really more difficult to learn for a child than other languages if you get started. Well, there might be some difference in phonetic in some languages which are where the phonetic system is a bit more blurry. So there could be some effects, but I don't think that this really, there's an inherent complexity. Well, in some sense, there's some complexity differences, but it shouldn't be really the effect that we can measure here. It's more that the model doesn't fit. And I think we can really agree that the models fit better to English. Something that also, if you look at those numbers before, so if you have statistical MT, and you have seen that picture before, a lot of effect came from the language model, from the target language model, and for English we have just much more data. So this was the effect why translations into English are usually much better. And that's also what you can see in Google Translate, at least in before, it was always much better into English because the systems were more developed for this, but also because you have much more data for English. So that's just the fact. Okay, but in any case, we can see that here we have an improvement that really was striking, something that really went over the expectations. Of course, it could be something with a test set, but there was more to this. And so something somehow happened in 2015, and this really turned the world upside down. So I changed that picture into that slide, which is actually the original one. So the original picture of that Walker triangle is this upside down. So now we're back to what it should be. And you can see also, you can probably imagine what happened is this neural MT. Turning it down maybe also makes sense because we talk about deep learning, so we go deep here. So. Okay, so this seems to be something that really changed the world inside of machine translation. Someone should keep track of time. So yeah, I have to fill 2 sessions, right?
Yes.
Yeah, let's see.
And 11, we have a problem.
Yeah. Okay. So, neural MT, finally we're there. So I spent a lot of time, but I think this is really important to go back to history and to see how this is embedded in how the development went. So what is neural MT? That's another question. So that's what you're waiting for, and the answer is, this is neural MT. So here we have the answer. You can see this is neural MT as one of the implementations, and this is the most common implementation nowadays. And with this, we conclude this session here. But maybe not really. So let's look at these details later in some more detail. But because we're still in the history part, we maybe look first in the development of neural MT. Because now, if you're in deep learning, and I've seen also here in the program that many of you work on some kind of deep learning neural methods and some of these methods. So most of these techniques and ideas are actually quite old. So they come from early days, probably earlier than that. Even in machine translation, neural machine translation, it is the case that neural MT is not really that new. It's not from 2015. But it just didn't work at a time when people really started to experiment with that. So also in MT, there were some ideas about integrating these kind of neural models or some, even in the same fashion that we talk about now, that we have some encoder, decoder, or sequence-to-sequence models that how people talk about, or using recurrent nets. That was already something that people looked at in the 1980s or 1990s. So there were some early attempts. They kind of failed in that period of time because there was just not the computational power, and then the methods and algorithms were not just developed enough for taking care of that problem. So there's the technical background was just not sufficient for getting really progress. So as you can see from 1987, the first attempt for having some kind of encoder-decoder model until 2013 or 14, there's quite a big break between developments. So it really took off in the 2013 or 10, when the first really useful implementations and systems came out that could handle larger data sets and then more complex problems. And you can see here that there's 2013 already, some pure neural MT was proposed. At that time, still quite much below the statistical approaches, but you can see that the entire field really quickly changed. So this is something that really didn't happen before, that in a short time of like 2 years or 3 years, we have this breakthrough that the first attempts of really implementing a pure neural MT system went to a commercial product that we have now online and people use it. So this is something I think that is kind of quite amazing to see that from something that was just an experiment and then doing that while trying to find a new kind of approach, we have now NMT systems launched in many different places. So this boom is something that really goes over the entire field and in many ways. So let's look at the early days once again. So you can see that it doesn't look so much different from the pictures that we are drawing now. Of course, they had different kinds of tools of drawing these pictures, but you can see that there's something that looks very familiar. We have these kind of dimensionality reduction ideas, then we have some recurrency, recurrent networks. We have encoder, decoder, which I will talk about later on again. So it's something that is really not in, well, there's the beginning is already set much earlier on. So in this 1987 paper, we can see something that is really a striking difference is, of course, that this is really working on toy examples. So if you look at current systems where you have millions of sentences and large vocabularies on high dimensional spaces, here they experimented with just a few thousand pairs, a few words only, so 31 English words, 40 Spanish words. So of course you cannot claim that you do anything serious here. And then there's 33 test sentences. So if you go to any kind of computer class or, I don't know, language technology class, you would never accept a paper that only evaluates on such a small kind of thing nowadays. So this is, of course, not a... It's a problematic evaluation here. So it didn't really take off. But then when the revival came, so there was already before 2015 quite a lot of ideas on using neural models, even inside of machine translation. And so one of the earliest ideas was to use this as some kind of component. So Holger Schwenk is one of these guys who did this before it was already, before it became cool to work on neural nets. He was working a lot on neural language models. And they try to find some way of integrating these ideas into existing frameworks. So here this idea would be that SMT, the statistical MT, is still the main engine for translation, but you can use this language model that now goes beyond just n-grams, but has a recurrency somehow for the entire sentence, and try to use this for re-ranking, for example. So you have different hypotheses, and you can re-rank your output by using some neural component afterwards, so some post-processing step. That was, I don't remember exactly how successful this is. You can see some improvements, maybe not the big breakthrough. Then probably the first really bigger breakthrough or that got really a lot of attention was how to integrate neural nets into SMT frameworks as one really integrated component. So can you use that language model really inside of the decoding steps? So in the searching procedures, can you use those things inside of the machinery? And then there were really some impressive improvements that could be shown by that paper, for example, by Devlin in 2014. So I think this then also created the first hype on let's get this working, or integrating neural nets even in MT. And then really quickly, also in 2014, I think there came the first models that really tried to build neural network solutions for the entire problem of machine translation. And this is something that, of course, we want to talk about more here, and also which is now kind of the state of the art is using this approach where you have basically a neural network that does the translation. So, okay. Yes?
This hype about gradients and word-to-word, did it affect machine translation?
Yes, yes, certainly. So this is, of course, also connected to neural language models, because language models were traditionally very important in machine translation, And I think the neural language models, of course, became more interesting for the idea of machine translation. Word embeddings as such, I have to remember if there were also some other attempts to integrate word embeddings. Well, I think this is the whole hype around deep learning, of course, also came to machine translation, certainly. And if we now look later, we will see that it's all about representation learning, and word embeddings will be part of this. But it's kind of not the component-wise view that you first train some embeddings, then use it in the application, but typically it's integrated. Yeah. But certainly the entire hype of neural processing affected the entire field. Okay, so what can we expect? Coming back to this, so here's a picture now, state-of-the-art systems. If we have English-German, for example, was one of the more complicated language pairs, and they did really a good job on getting a syntax-based model to work for English-German. So Rico Senrich and Barry Haddo and some other people, they worked on this, really having a sophisticated model from a linguistic point of view, taking care of the problems mapping English to German, and it was really the best system around. But then you could see that from still in 2015, it was difficult to beat SMT models for many language pairs. And there's certain problems that you have to address because the model is restricted in many ways. For example, in the dimensionality, it has to be fixed for some embeddings. If you talk about embeddings again, you also have to fix, for example, how many symbols can you actually map to some internal representation. So you have the problem that you cannot easily make an open vocabulary system. So you cannot integrate millions of words because then the parameter space becomes so big that the system cannot handle it. And also the system doesn't have enough evidence for all these low frequency words which you typically have in language. So this is one problem that we always have to face in language processing, that most individual words have low frequency. So the CIPF's laws is always hurting these data-driven systems. But then there's a lot of ideas that we will also talk about later on how you can break that problem. So how can you, for example, handle these out of vocabulary words by doing some heuristics, because they're really important. You have to take care of that, otherwise your translation will not work. But you can also go beyond below word level and say you can break things down into smaller units. This helped a little bit, but then if you then also combine this with more, there's a lot of tricks and hacks and little things that you have to take care of to get the performance of the learning procedure to work. So now these learning procedures usually are not deterministic, so you get there's a randomized effect here. You get different models, and then people realized if you do some exampling, so we use different kind of models, then we have a huge improvement. So this is something that boosted somehow the systems quite a lot. So combining different outputs made a really big jump in combination with handling out of vocabulary words. So you could already here go beyond the state of the art in SMT. And another really crucial thing is that neural models, they're just trained on parallel texts, but in SMT and statistical MT, you could see that monolingual texts were really important for doing language modeling, but there was no obvious way on how to integrate that in neural MT. And integrating that in some way also gave yet another boost. So you can see there's a steady improvement by just doing exactly what also happened in statistical MT, all kinds of little tricks and hacks and changes that gave you a little boost here. And in the end, we now have within 1 year, you could see that there was really this huge improvement, that you could see gains that really outperformed statistical or syntax-based statistical MT by quite some margin. So then you would like to know, of course, why is that happening? Is that happening for other languages? So we have also other people that looked at different language pairs. And here, I don't know, there's probably other papers as well, but this is one paper that compared phrase-based SMT to neural MT, and you can see here what is the difference in Bleu scores between these different models. And so if you see that for some language pairs, we have really huge improvements by up to 9 blur points, I think, here for Spanish, Chinese. Now, this is kind of brute force testing for some test sets, so let's take this with a grain of salt. But you can see that almost in all cases, we get a gain for using neural MT just out of the box without doing a lot of different things, but also taking, of course, phrase-based systems out of the box. So in terms of blur scores, this seems to be really relevant for most language pairs. Of course, you can still argue this is only 6 languages out of 6,000 or 7,000, but yeah, well, so we can talk about that also later. But what happens especially is that we can see that these neural models really have some tendencies to improve fluency. So there seem to be something that are good in long distance, while some dependencies that go beyond just simple n-grams and produce something that looks much more grammatical than for other systems would have produced. So here's one evaluation where they only looked at fluency, and you could see that also for different language pairs, from different languages to English, you could see that the fluency really goes up by using neural methods, which now especially is surprising if you look into this into English, where you know that English has quite a lot of monolingual data, where you assume that you have good language models. So all of these are, of course, depending on test sets and all kinds of settings, but the tendencies really can be seen. Then also Rico Senrich had a really nice paper where he wanted to look into more detail about what kind of linguistic aspects are really improved, or what kind of errors are taken away if you use neural systems. And then he developed some kind of test suites where you can test exactly those kind of differences that you can get. So if you compare, then they did some comparison for these different error cases, and the systems really showed that, for example, for morphology, NMT performed just much better if you have some inflectional morphology that you have to take care of. Word order problems were taken care of by NMT with really a large margin, much better error reduction. But also something that goes more into adequacy, so it's not only fluency only, but leaving out some words, for example, doesn't happen that much in neural MT, or adding some words that are not really, should not be there, also the reduction of errors here, but also mistranslations. So you can see also adequacy seems to be, have some preferable situation for neural MT. Of course, more and more evaluations are needed to really figure out what is the advantage of these systems. And then once again, if you have manual evaluation in WMT, so in this shared task, you can see that nowadays it's all the neural systems that win the competition, even in the manual evaluations. So manual evaluations, you can see that the purely neural systems are the winning systems in those competitions, at least. So here we have English to Finnish, where they're from 2016, I think, the results were a purely NMT system really won the competition. And that's not only for that language pair the case. Okay. So, as I said also earlier, now we can see that neural becomes the standard in many of these companies. And if you go to conferences nowadays, then many of these companies really surround all people who know anything about deep learning and neural MT, and the job situation is quite good for getting into the industry. And you can see that many of these companies also try to go into machine translation. So it's really not only Google who tries to get into this. Google launched neural MT for some time ago already, and most language pairs use neural MT in the online system. But we have systems that are developed by Amazon. Apple is implementing this kind of thing. Also, there will be integrated with Siri. Facebook has some translation service that they developed themselves. So they're also they attract a lot of these academic researchers to get into their research team and to build up these models. So now, what is your impression about Facebook translations? Do they improve now? I always found that a bit funny still, but I'm not exactly sure if they are now neural, but they work really hard on this. I know also Microsoft is putting a lot of effort into this. I think that Facebook is now independent of Microsoft, because before it was just bought the service from Microsoft, but now they have their own systems. We have also here a newcomer from Germany that just quickly came out with a new online system that does translation into several languages. So you can see that this is something that really took off very quickly. I have one more example, so also in academic research, we can see that this is really working. I was once attending this conference in Tallinn, and then they set up an integrated translation for the speakers that spoke in Estonian, and you could see the translation into English on a site simultaneously. So I found this quite impressive that they had this setup that speech recognition and translation was integrated, and you could in this way really integrate that people could follow the talks that were given. I was present there, and I can tell you that the translations were rather entertaining. And probably not what they said, but I cannot judge it, but would have been really funny talks that they gave at this IT conference. But then you could see that there was a mismatch between training data and the system's input, because they were trained on movie subtitles, and you can see a lot of movie subtitle quotes coming out of serious presentations. Really interesting. Okay. So I spent quite some time in this kind of introduction. So let's go more into the depth of what is the secret between neural MT, and what does it really make it perform so much better? Why does this impressive situation comes from? And it really comes down to the same thing as really changed also the world in many other fields in AI and in language processing. It is about this representation learning. It's just the fact that this seems to be something that had been ignored for too long. We need some representations that go beyond just having a symbolic representation of something. Even if we do abstractions, it doesn't make much sense to have some kind of division into discrete symbols that really are independent of each other and don't have a connection. So the secret of NMT must be, and is most certainly, the representations in this kind of continuous space, which for me also really makes sense. So if you think of how we understand things, we don't understand things in exactly the same way, but we have a kind of fuzzy matching between the signal that comes in and the things that we really understand, that we make out of this. So the meaning that we try to get is some approximation. And this is really nicely done by continuous space representations, where you really have distances and similarities that explain how much meanings really differ from each other. You have this mapping to some continuous space. So this is really the secret, the whole secret behind the whole success of language processing with deep learning and neural nets. And of course, then there's a lot of details on how this really gets implemented into some real network systems, where you also have the dependencies between units and you have to handle, for example, compositionality in some way. But all of these successes would not be possible if we could not get that mapping. And then, of course, the secret also is that you can learn this from data. So this mapping, of course, is nice, but you have to get it from somewhere. And you have to get this from data, or for some input, from some experience. And the secret is really that now we have models that can learn these continuous representations, but we also have data. So it's not really such a big surprise that for language pairs where you don't have a lot of data, you cannot get this output here. So we did, for example, some experiments for very low resource languages, and then still neural systems cannot perform as well as simple pattern matching SMT models, because they cannot get to a reasonable abstraction. So, secret is data and representation learning. And the thing is that this really goes beyond word embeddings. So everyone knows word embeddings, and this is almost like a bad word nowadays, because you don't want to hear that anymore, that someone is talking about word embeddings. But the interesting thing is that in MT, in neural MT, you go beyond words and you want to embed, or you want to represent longer units. So you will get some representation of a whole sentence, typically. But it doesn't have to be a sentence, it can be any kind of unit. So you want to map that kind of thing into some continuous space. And exactly as with word embeddings, you try to map that into a space that represents somehow the meaning, or the relations between the different sentences represent the meaning differences or the similarities between sentences. So here's this is kind of early work from 2014, when really the first NMT systems came out, that you could, if you now look at what the NMT system does, where does it map a certain sentence to, you can also visualize this in some space. And you could really see that something that really was always one of the biggest problems in machine translation or in any kind of computational linguistics, how do we map things that mean the same but look very different to some similar representations, that happens automatically by the system. So it really learns these kind of relations to some extent, at least. So here, that's probably some cherry picking of certain examples, but you can see that things that really are different in their surface structure become quite close in that space here. Then, of course, this is also, again, a bit, you have to always take these pictures with a grain of salt, because this is now mapped on two dimensions to make it visible. But of course, this is in a higher dimensional space here. But you can see really that a system can pick up these things. And this seems to be essential, and the essential success for neural MT. So you can see that meaning is somehow represented in space. And you can also see that there's some regularity in that space. So if there's, for example, slight differences between meaning-bearing units, you can see similar kind of differences in other regions with different agents or with different units. Again, this is a bit cherry-picking, and maybe it makes all the hype, of course, that you can show some of these pictures where you can see that you can calculate things over that space and make certain reductions. But of course, it's really impressive that this can be picked up. You probably all know these examples about king minus man plus woman is queen or something similar. But of course, not in all cases this works as well. But it's kind of nice to see that a system can really pick those regularities up. And the interesting thing is, of course, can we do this for really longer sequences and longer sentences and longer units? So just to summarize, the problem was before, and why we were stuck, was because we had symbolic representations of everything we did. So statistical MT was also stuck in that kind of symbolic representation. We had phrases which are made out of these words. There's no abstraction there. There's some way that we try to get into the abstraction level to introduce, for example, some kind of symbolic syntax or some kind of abstraction to some symbolic representation. But still, we have symbolic representations that have a limitation in explaining what are the small differences between the meaning that is behind certain expressions. So statistics in those systems only help to do some kind of disambiguation, but the representation is always the same. It's very much focused on discrete symbols. And if we have neural MT, now we get these kind of non-symbolic representations that make the difference. So, okay. Let's see, I don't have a good point for breaking, so I have to see how much. So we have more or less 10 more minutes, yeah. Okay, let's get at some details here. So what is the typical setup for dual MT is that we divide this into two parts. As you have seen in the picture before, we would have an encoder and we would have a decoder. So we have an encoder that tries to get from the input, for example a sentence, into the encoded abstract representation of some non-symbolic vector space. So you would have a sentence like this, which is now of course symbolic, and you try to map that into this vectorial representation. So basically you want to find a function that gets from some kind of encoding of this one here, the symbolic representation, into this very dense dimensional, well, high dimensional representation, but which is dense and distributed over all these different vectorial dimensions here. So this is something that you have to learn, how to map this input here to some representation. And then you have to also learn how to get from that representation to unroll it into some symbolic representation again with this sentence that you want to produce. So the decoding thing. And this is the picture that you have seen before. And we will probably more after the break go into some of the details, but let's look at this. So this is one of the first proposals that they had for a fully integrated neural system for machine translation. And this is basically the same as we had seen before, but now explaining how we can do that mapping from one sequence of words like this into a representation, which is this red dot here. And then how this red dot is then unrolled into the actual translation that you get on the top. And then maybe this is really familiar for many of you, is that you start by trying to find some encoding for words. So you have to find out how can you encode the individual words. And now, in a similar way as it is done in other approaches, we have to find some digital encoding. And here, this is just a one-hot encoding saying that we just mark the dimension of that vocabulary item. So this vector here would have the size of the vocabulary, saying that each dimension represents one specific word that we have in our vocabulary. Then this becomes embedded, meaning that we want to, because this doesn't give us a lot of information, everything is really orthogonal to each other, so there's no relation between words, but all that information becomes embedded into some lower dimensional space. Let's say we have maybe, I don't know, 256 dimensions instead of 50,000 here, and we map that into a dense representation for each word, which then will be the input to our recurrent network that we built up here. So now we have a sequential model again that that tries to get the input from that word embedding and tries to get a function how to produce some output from that input. Some initialization is missing here, and then gives this further to the next node here, and somehow summarizes all the history that comes from the left-hand side here. So we move through the sentence, taking the kind of embedded information, and send it through the recurrent network to summarize from the beginning until the end what we have seen. So the intuition here is that this is similar to reading. We read or listen to some input, and then we memorize things, and then just summarize what we have heard. And in the end, this hopefully, this kind of encoding that we get out of this, would summarize the entire information in some numerical vector space of the entire input that we have seen here. So having that done, we now get a summarizing vector, which we hope in this learning phase has learned to really abstract away from the entire information that we have seen here. And now we send that kind of information that we have, the entire sentence, into yet another recurrent network. So the input to the first node goes here. And from there, we try to get to learn some output. So what kind of symbol can we generate from here? And this is done by some kind of softmax layer in the end. So we get some probability distribution over all words in the vocabulary of the target language. And we pick something that that according to this probability distribution has a likelihood to be in the starting point. And then we take that choice that we have, so the word sample, does that work here? So we have the actual word that is selected will be the input to the next step. And we learn also a function that then maps to the next step. So it reduces the information by the thing that has been already used, goes to the next step, and tries also to integrate the information about what word has been actually selected, and then again tries to find this distribution over all words in the vocabulary and picks one for the next step. So it really generates word by word from left to right and goes through this recurrent network here until it generates an end symbol. So it only stops, it actually only stops if there's an end symbol that has been generated. So it doesn't have to be the same number of items here and there. So, and this is also natural. We have just a sequence of things that generates until it feels like stopping. So let me see if this
5 minutes.
I don't know if this is almost good. So is that kind of clear how this, the idea behind this is here? Yes?
The beginner's question really, what's the size of the input? So how do we feed phrase to this neural
network? So the input is would be a sentence like this? Or what, you mean in training or in?
No, I mean the size, like how many at a time do we, how many words at a time do we feed? Or it's like convolutional layer?
No, it's a recurrent, so it's really, there's also convolutional networks, but this is a completely recurrent thing, so it always just gives the entire information further through the, so you cannot, you don't jump between different regions. Yeah. So this is really just individual words that are mapped to some embedding.
Yeah.
So there's no convolution or anything. Yeah, so you have a fixed dimensionality for these. So for example, you have to choose the vocabulary size.
Yeah.
And this is typically something that you can now manage nowadays with the technology is something like 50,000, 60,000, depending on. So, and this will be a problem that we will discuss later, because the 50,000 is not the vocabulary that you have in typical languages. You would have more items, especially if you don't do inflectional reduction.
So.
That is really open, because you can have arbitrary length here. So that is no restriction. But we will see later on that this becomes a restriction, because the information that you can compress into one vector is limited. So capacity of the model is limited by the dimensionality of this vector. So here you have this hidden layer here has a fixed dimensionality. Let's say 1,000 dimensions, for example. That's quite a common thing. But then you can argue that, is it really possible to have arbitrary long sentences compressed into 1,000 dimensions? And this is, of course, not the case. So that's a problem. You have to give this, so the networks are always set up that you have to fix dimensionality. So you also have to fix the dimensionality of the embedding. That's also common for other types. So you have, I don't know, maybe 512 dimensions or whatever you want to. For compressing the information about individual words, then you might have something like 1,000 dimensions here in this hidden layer, and this will be always the same kind of dimensionality. You'd have the same weight vector, because it's a recurrent unit, so this weight vector is learned is a shared vector, so it will always just copy, so the same weight vector for transforming that information into this, and that's the same for this as well. So this recurrent network layer here also will have a fixed size, let's say also 1,000 dimensions, and will also have a fixed weight vector for doing that mapping, and also for this mapping. Yeah. So, and these are exactly the problems that we have to discuss, I guess, after the break. Are there other questions about this? Yes?
So this 1,000 dimension, is it a real number or?
Yeah. So, well, here we have, well, kind of real numbers. Of course, they're digitized somehow. But yeah, that should be real numbers here also. This is one. We use, for example, 1,000 for the hidden layer for something that we have submitted for our system, which was kind of working well. And also, this is something that you have to fiddle around a little bit to optimize somehow to the setup. So I think we have mostly 1,000, maybe 2,000 in some settings. We often have embeddings that have a size of maybe 512 or I don't know, some dimensions like this. The same for the output vocabulary as well. I think there's something like 500, maybe 1,000 dimensions for the embeddings. But this is something that I wouldn't. So if you look at production systems like Google, they would have several of these layers as well. So you can also get several of these recurrent layers stacked on top of each other to do even more abstractions on some other levels. I think they have up to eight layers of encoding. Recurrent encoding layers. Yeah. Anyone who is really familiar with word embeddings, what is the best word embedding size? It's also kind of an open question. Is there a good recommendation of what dimensionality is best for a certain language? What would you use? You all do word embeddings, right? What is your favorite word dimensionality? You just take the standard setting, Vertevec, and then what is that, 500? I don't know.
Depends on the data.
Yeah, no, that's the same answer here as well. And it depends on your GPU. So you have to fit it into memory there. So of course, all these parameters become then, well, have to be fit into memory on some kind of device where you can train. And that restricts what you can do. Do we deserve some coffee now, or I don't know what? It's okay, we go back to this and then also to some real extensions of this, because this is the simplest model. So this is the one that doesn't work.